So this is going to be a demonstration of the posterior aspect of the thigh. This is a prone cadaver. We are showing the right side. The camera person is on the left side. So we have dissected out the structures on the posterior aspect of the right thigh. This is the ischial tuberosity. And we can see the hamstring muscles on the back of the thigh. So let's first quickly name them. This muscle that we see here in front of us, this is the biceps femoris. The long head of the biceps takes origin from the ischial tuberosity. And deep to that, we can see this is the short head of the biceps, which takes origin from the linea aspera. And the two fibers then unite to form the biceps, and it gets inserted onto the head of the fibula. This forms the supralateral boundary of the popliteal fossa. The next hamstring muscle is this one which we have picked up here. And we can see that the lower part is a narrow tendon. So therefore, this is the semitendinosus. This also takes origin from the ischial tuberosity. And it continues down as a thin tendon, and it gets inserted as the pes anserinus, which is a triple insertion of three muscles, one each from the anterior, medial, and posterior compartment, namely the sartorius, gracilis, and semitendinosus. Just to digress for 1 minute, this is the gracilis tendon. And we can see that the gracilis tendon also is going in the same direction as the semitendinosus. The next muscle under the semitendinosus is this fleshy muscle that we see here. This is the semimembranosus. And this also gets inserted onto the medial side of the tibia, and it gives numerous expansions to the posterior aspect of the knee. It reinforces the posterior capsule of the knee joint, it forms the oblique and the arcuate popliteal ligament, and it reinforces the popliteus fascia. These two muscles together, they constitute the supromedial boundary of the popliteal fossa. So we have seen the three muscles, main muscles of the hamstring group. Now I shall reflect this to show you the next muscle inside, deep inside. We can see some of that muscle from here. I'm reflecting these two to show the rest of the muscle, and I'm going to reflect further to show you the muscle here. This is the adductor magnus. The adductor magnus has got two parts. One portion gets inserted onto the linea aspera, that is the adductor part. And another portion gets inserted onto the adductor tubercle, that is the hamstring component of the adductor magnus. The common action of all the hamstring muscle is extension of the hip, flexion of the knee. But they cannot perform both actions simultaneously to the fullest extent. There are exceptions. For example, the short head of the biceps cannot act on the hip joint. The adductor magnus hamstring component cannot flex the knee joint. So these are some exceptions to the rules of the hamstrings. So these are the muscles that we can see in the posterior compartment. Now let's take a look at the neurovascular structures. The most prominent neurovascular structure we can see here is this nerve here. And this is the sciatic nerve. And we can see the sciatic nerve is coming from the gluteal region. It is running between the ischial tuberosity and the greater trochanter. It crosses the gluteal region, the deep gluteal muscles. And then it enters into the thigh. And in the posterior aspect of the thigh, it runs between two muscle layers. It runs between the main hamstring group and the adductor magnus. Ideally, according to the textbooks, somewhere at the junction of the upper two-thirds and the lower one-third of the thigh, it is supposed to divide into a tibial component and a common fibular component. But in this particular case, we notice that there is a variation. The sciatic nerve is dividing in the popliteal fossa itself into a tibial component and a common fibular component. The tibial component runs right across the center of the popliteal fossa, while the common fibula runs infralaterally under cover of the biceps femoris. Hamstring muscles are all supplied by the tibial division of sciatic nerve, which is the preaxial division, except the short head of the biceps, which gets supplied from the common fibular division. Now I would draw your attention to these neurovascular structures. We can see numerous neurovascular structures here, and we can see some of them here also. These are what are known as perforator arteries. There are four perforators which come from the profunda femoris. The profunda femoris is the deep branch of the femoral artery, which is in the anterior compartment. And the profunda femoris runs just in close proximity to the insertion of the adductor magnus anteriorly. And from the profunda femoris, four arteries perforate through the adductor magnus, and they come to the posterior aspect, That is why they are called perforator arteries. If you notice, the posterior compartment of the thigh does not have any artery of its own. So therefore, its blood supply is entirely dependent on these perforators, the four perforators. And let's take a look at them one by one. This is the first perforator. And we can see it is piercing through the insertion of the adductor magnus near the linea aspera. This first perforator participates in the cruciate anastomosis around the greater trochanter. And this is the other contribution to the cruciate anastomosis from the inferior gluteal artery. This is the second perforator. This also pierces the adductor magnus near its insertion to the linea aspera. We can see that these perforators, they are piercing and they're supplying the muscles. And when I retract them, we can see that they are within the posterior compartment. And when I pull here, we can see they're moving there. So these are all the branches from the first perforator and the second perforator. If we were to look closely, ideally we are supposed to find a third perforator somewhere here, but here we notice that the third perforator is rather low down, and this is the third perforator. This is also piercing through the adductor magnus, and it is ramifying in the muscles of the posterior compartment. The fourth perforator is supposed to be close to the adductor hiatus. This is the adductor hiatus. But here we see that the fourth perforator is missing. Instead, it is replaced by this contribution from the popliteal artery. So this is taken over the role of the fourth perforator, and it is supplying the muscles from the posterior compartment in the popliteal fossa. So the role of these perforators is to supply all the muscles of the posterior compartment. That brings me to some important clinical correlation pertaining to the hamstring muscle. When an Olympic hurdler forcibly extends his knee and flexes the hip, there is tension exerted on the hamstring muscles, and it can lead to rupture of the hamstring tendon here. Or if it's an adolescent, it can produce avulsion fracture of the epiphysis of the ischial tuberosity. And that is a very serious disability. The person cannot extend the hip and flex the knee. So that is called avulsion fracture of the ischial tuberosity or avulsion rupture of the hamstring tendon. This is an X-ray to show avulsion fracture of the epiphysis of the ischial tuberosity in an adolescent. So these are all the points which I want to mention about the hamstring muscles. Thank you very much for watching. If you have any questions or comments, please put them in the comment section below. Dr. Sanjoy Sanyal signing out. MD1 students are my assistants. Have a nice day.